Okay, joking aside, I love your meeting. I love your Congress because we see where the not the only one with disasters and isolated with our disasters. Aortic disaster, I've had a few in my over my career. I thought I'd pick the last one in my fenestrated prosthesis in my small clinic across from the university hospital. No disclosure, except in no conflict of interest, except with the lawyer of the patient. And this Congress enables us to say that you should learn from your mistakes. And Gaston Bachelard used to say that scientific progress is but a succession of rectified errors. As this whole day has shown, shit attracts shit, or as Mr. Chirac used to say, shit comes in fleets or in a flying squadron. I took this example, which is comes from the Nordic seas. There was a driver who was probably a bit drunk and fell with his car in the water, which they're trying to pull out with the lorry. In the beginning, things are okay, as always with our procedures, and then suddenly the lorry tips over. So what do we do? Well, you go and get a second a truck, and you take the car out, and no problem there. Then you try to get the truck out, and guess what happens? Well, now the second truck tips over. We've heard quite a few cases like this today. And so now we come to the next truck. I haven't got the final slide, but let's hope everything ended up well. Okay. Coming to my clinical case, an 84-year-old lady, very good general status, came for abdominal aorta, evolutionary dissecting aneurysm. And the interesting thing is that 84 years old, you would say she's not very young, but she wants to live a long time. She's in a great state. And she promised that she'd teach me rock and roll if she made it. So to me, it was a real challenge. Antecedents or history. In 2010, she had dissection of the aorta treated by a replacement of the ascending aorta and a bental. In 2014, she had open surgery, left thoracotomy. The only risk factor is that her high blood pressure hadn't been treated. So, evolutionary aortic aneurysm, 58 millimeters, subarenal snare, less than 1 centimeters. Normal celiac trunk, superior and mesenteric and left renal arteries. The right renal artery is probably occluded. The mesenteric, as I said, is okay. The renal artery, as you can see, is angulated. And there's quickly a bifurcation, but we knew we'd have a slight problem. So here you have the other scans. Here you have the celiac trunk. Not much problem, it seems. Superior mesenteric artery, good diameter, 1145, you see it. And the renal. Has an early bifurcation, but with a wide ostium. So in the beginning, I started the intervention, inserted the guide without any problem. I thought I wouldn't have any problem. So operating field plan, we thought we'd join the old processes with an endo processes and have a fenestrated one with three fenestrations because we thought three would be better than four, which was a mistake. Here you have the graft plan. Once again, nothing very special. There's one thing which I really underestimated. There's a difference in diameter between the celiac artery, which is about 25 in that place, and the bifurcation of the aorta below, where you have like something like 17 or 18. So this is a factor that was mentioned this morning, which really has to be taken into account. Here you have the prosthesis and the diagram, three fenestrations. And for the bifurcated one, as the aorta was rather short, we did what we call an inner branch, meaning that rather than having a branch that branches out, we have a branch going back into the prosthesis in order to avoid to be blocked in the aorta when you're not at the bifurcation. So no problem up till now, hybrid room, general anesthetics, monitoring with an automatic monitoring of the pressure in the LTR, an oximeter on the legs. I don't know if you're used to that, but when you think you're going to clamp common femoral arteries for a long time, using this oximeter gives you a good indication. In my opinion, it's a nice little trick, the oximeter. Then image acquisition, we work in 3D, short horizontal incision on the scarpas, and a bursa on the epsis. So no problem with the arteriography, confirming the data from the CT scan. We put in the thoracic prosthesis, and then the abdominal one. The fenestration is really corresponds to the ostium. And we do an angiography. We see the fenestration, the renal, but we see there's a slight mismatch, but not worrying. It looks okay, especially as at the top everything was okay, so we thought it had opened properly. So we catheterize the transiliac. We leave the guides in place. And we're happy. Incision at 9:10, end of deployment of the prosthesis 10:15, end of catheterism of the superior mesenteric celiac trunk 10:45. We think, well, like the others, we'll have a nice lunch. Okay, but then we see the renal, we think it's not going to be too complicated. We put in a guide and we say, oh, what is this? Where is the distal part of my renal artery? I can't understand what's happening. So you remove the guide, re-inject, and then you see a phantom of renal rather posteriorly with the probe in the fenestration. But things are not going like you would like. So in the renal, you try everything, probe, guide, all sizes, all shapes, the positions of the hoops, you have the image, and you can't get there. We try to move the prosthesis to reposition it and reposition the fenestration in a more adequate, more appropriate place. Very carefully, clockwise and anti-clockwise rotation, but we dare not go beyond 15 degrees, a moderate vertical displacement. Time passes, 2 o'clock, renal is not catheterized. We didn't have lunch, I can tell you, 3 p.m., still not done. And we're starting to be stressed, and we don't understand that we had the right measurement. The fenestration seemed to correspond. Was it a thrombosis of the renal artery? Is it a dissection, or is it a mispositioning? But then why? Because we deployed everything properly, and it didn't seem to have moved. So what can we do? I don't know. Either we give up, but if we give up, what happens? You get an endoleak, and if the artery is blocked, you have final dialysis. This 84-year-old patient who felt well and wanted to continue living in a good condition, that was difficult to accept. Left iliorenal bypass, as in Clermont-Ferrand, and trying to close the fenestration. Well, maybe, but it was a bit late, and there's a time when everybody get discouraged. Or repositioning the processes. Yes, okay, but how? Because you're always afraid to damage what you've done at the top. And finally, I have something that I always do, since I was in the private sector. I have a little booklet with numbers of friends who could help me out when I am in a difficult position. So I called Stéphane. Took him a long time to come over on the motorbike and to solve the problem. And I was really bluffed, because instead of rotating the processes by 15 degrees as I did, he went to 360 and then back 180, and he was able to find the fenestration and the guide and the catheter and put them back in a correct position, and things ended up in a rather favorable position. This is the post-operative report. Doppler control is okay. Small leak from the left renal stent. And then the scan I got this morning on the phone. As you can see, the mesenteric and celiac trunk are patent, and things are working properly. So what are the lessons we can learn from that? I didn't think it would be such a complicated case. But obviously, as we know, the orientation of the visceral branches is absolutely essential. And if you have an acute posterior angulation, it can be a problem. Early bifurcation can be a problem. And the length of the stent is to be taken into account, because you have to put in a shorter one if you want to retain the kidney, and we wanted to retain the kidney. And because she only had one. And the important thing is the difference in diameter of the upper and lower aorta. And that was a problem when we deployed the upper and lower processes, and you couldn't move it anymore because it was blocked in the aorta because of the difference in diameter. And then you have to be somewhat extreme to move it. And the only problem is to know which way to turn. So anti-clockwise is always a difficult exercise. So it's really same thing as I heard this morning. I don't know if you know Kate Bush, but she's a great jazz singer. And she sings Don't Give Up. So please never give up. But don't hesitate to call on a friend who's not far away, and who at one point when you're getting tired also at the end of the procedure will help you out. Thank you very much. When he did his rotation, had you kept the superior mesenteric guide? Yes, just the guides, celiac trunk and superior mesenteric guide. I'm always afraid that the assistant or yourself will remove the guide and you have to start again. But if you separate the guides properly, honestly, I haven't had any problem, never. At least I stopped working before it happened to me. But it's better because you have more space and you can circulate and move around in the processes easier. Where were you? You went through the fenestration and you catheterized something. I don't know, or maybe I was in the upper branch of the renal, or I was in the aorta, and the image I could see was the lumen of something else. So they had a bad orientation, a bad direction of the fenestration. Yes, same case as Genio. Here it was not a plicature, but a very narrow aorta. And once you've deployed the processes, the fenestration is not exactly well placed, you have very few means of putting it back. What can we expect from this rotation and derotation maneuver? Because you still had an excess. What did it do? It sort of unfolded the Dacron? Yes, it probably unfolded. I don't know. That must have been a complete twist of the prosthesis underneath, a kind of helix or coil, which means the fenestration was blocked. And then you have to dare rotate it like that. Well, it worked. Jean-Pierre, maybe if you'd had a torque, the tour guide by Medtronic, if you'd put it in the fenestration, you could have moved it to restore the right orientation. Well, we did have the tour guide. Did I use it? I think I used it, but it wasn't working. Well, you know, it's always the same. You say, if I have my guides at the top, if I move everything, things are going to move in the wrong way. And the right solution was to do what he did, i.e. to turn the processes in the right direction. But you need an outside vision at one point. When you moved it by 15 degrees, the fenestration, it was moving, but not sufficiently, let's say. So when he moved it, did the guides that were in the other arteries, did they move? Well, no, because, you know, it moved the distal part. That was... Because you had, as I said, a difference in diameter in the upper and lower part, and it was difficult also to channel the renal artery because of the problem orientation. Well, I think we can conclude that getting a new vision from someone else can be a great help.